Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Too much on my plate. Don't have no time to be a decent lover. I hope it isn't too late. Searching for the time that has gone so fast. The time that I thought would last. My ever-present past. I've got too much on my mind. I think of everything to be discovered. I hope there's something to find. Searching for the time that has gone so fast. The time that I thought would last. My ever-present past. The things I think I did. I do not think I did. But the things I think I did when I was a kid. I couldn't understand the words that they were saying, but still I hung around and took it all in. I wouldn't join in with the games that they were playing. It went by, it went by in a flash. It flew by, it flew by. There's far too much on my plate. Don't have no time to be a decent lover. I hope it's never too late. Searching for the time that has come so fast. The time that I thought would last. My ever-present past. The things I think I did. I think I did. The things I think I did when I was a kid. What's the things I think I did. I think I did. The things I think I did when I was a kid. When I was a kid.
Than ever, and we're on fire, making our way. when you only got 100 years to live.
If you never had to forget anything, trends in storage, sensing, and computing will bring about an e-memory revolution in the next 100 years that will enable you to record as much of your life as you want, in previously unimaginable detail. Everything you see, hear, every step you take, every heartbeat, all of it could be captured digitally. You could have total recall. Total recall will revolutionize our health, our learning, our productivity. It will change the story we pass on to prosperity, taking us to a level of digital immortality. The consequences to society will be profound, some good and some bad. But good or bad, our experiences with the MyLifeBits research project and the CARPE research community has convinced us that the e-memory revolution is inevitable. Jim Gemmel is a senior researcher at Microsoft Research. He's currently working on the next generation of search. Previously, Jim's research focused on MyLifeBits, part of the CARPE research community, whose first and second workshops he was proud to chair. Jim has also done research on the topics of personal media management, enhancement, telepresence, and reliable multicast. His research has led to features in Windows XP, Windows Server 2008, Windows 7, and Bing.com. He lives in the Bay Area. And Gordon Bell has been a principal researcher at Microsoft Research since 1995. He's a former vice president of R&D at Digital Equipment Corporation, professor at Carnegie Mellon University, founding assistant director of the National Science Foundation's SCIES Directorate, advisor, investor to 100-plus high-tech startup companies, and a founding trustee of the Computer History Museum in Mountain View. He's written several books about computer architecture and high-tech ventures. Gordon created the ACM's Gordon Bell Prize in 1987 to acknowledge and reward progress in parallel processing. He's a fellow of the ACM, the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, the IEEE, NAE, NAS, and the 1991 National Medal of Technology medalist. Please welcome me in, or join me in welcoming Jim Gimmel and Gordon Bell.
There we go. Hello. We're here to talk to you about our book, Total Recall. And there's so much to talk about and so little time we have here. Of course, it takes a whole book to go into depth. What I'm going to try to do is get through the material pretty quickly and have plenty of time to have a discussion with the points that are of particular interest to you. So I'm qualified to speak on the subject because I'm losing my mind. Which is not to say that I need a... Hello.
Hello.
Is that better?
Did anything just happen? Okay. Not that I'm going crazy, but that I need things like this. And hopefully Gordon and I find the car where we parked in the parking lot afterwards. That's the way it goes with me these days. But what if you could remember absolutely everything? What if you could remember everything you've ever read, everything you've ever seen, everything you've ever heard, and much more beyond what you think of as human memory typically? What's the temperature in the room right now? What's the humidity? Sensors all over the place. Well, the premise of the book is that soon, if you want, you can have total recall, as much or as little as you like, but certainly way more than ever before. Even the people who we think are recoiling at the notion of this will still have a record of their life that would have blown away previous generations. There's three streams of technology that are going to take us, for sure, down the road to total recall. The first is recording devices. They're already all over the place. Digital cameras are going crazy out there. We're carrying around cell phones that, think of what you can do with a cell phone. We've got audio recording, we've got video recording in most of them. We can take pictures. Some of them have your location. They're amazing devices for recording. As we go forward, pretty much everything that can be instrumented will be instrumented in a world just full of sensors. The second stream is storage. We all know it's so incredibly cheap and abundant and just getting more so all the time. We can store all this stuff. And the third stream is software. The software to find the stuff, to recall it, to search for things, to do analysis, to do data mining, to visualize to us and help us make sense of it and manage it. Based on those three streams of technology and what we've learned from our own experience, we believe the next 10 years is going to see a revolution in the world. It's going to change society for sure, and that total recall is inevitable. Now, to clarify, what we're not talking about is life blogging. If you are one of those people who like to post, if you're like Jenny with the Jenny Cam or someone on Justin TV, and you like to publish your life, go ahead, fine. I'm not going to tell you not to, but I think you're crazy. We would never do anything like that. For us, we think of it more like this. It's my diary with the lock on it. It's personal. It's intimate. It's for my benefit, nobody else's. And if I share, I'm going to share a little bit very carefully. Now, that's my personal preference, but that's what this is all about. If you want to take it then and share it, that's a different topic. So, before we get into it, we're going to talk a lot about, can you just hold for a second? I want to try and get through the material, and then we'll field a lot of questions at the end, because I promise you, we don't have time to even cover a bit of the book here, so I know we're going to leave a lot untouched. I just want to make sure we get through things. What I want to do is, I want to tell you a little bit about our background, how we got into this. Gordon's going to describe that, actually. Then we're going to talk about some of the advantages of total recall that we've learned, and talk about the societal implications. So, Gordon, why don't you take it away now? You got the arrows on there.
Okay, let's see. Okay, that one?
Yeah.
Okay, it's kind of all started back in October 98 when Raj Reddy sent me an email and said, can I take some of your books and scan them? Because we're starting the Million Book Project and we want to see about formatting, and how you do it, and what the quality, and just generally do some experiments with those books. And so I said, sure, don't worry about copyrights because Microsoft has a lot of lawyers. Now, it turns out if at that particular point in time, those lawyers were pretty busy. And so, fortunately, and I don't think they would have been very happy if I'd come to them with one more problem. So anyway, but that was the beginning. It actually stimulated me thinking because I'd been carrying boxes of papers around for a long, long time. And I started doing some scanning experiments and just to see what format you use and how good the recognizers were in terms of OCRs, because in fact, scanning per se is no good unless the computer knows what they're scanned. So basically, the whole thesis of MyLifeBits is the computer's got to know everything it's got in there, and that's a challenge for you guys, which is to make it that way. So whether it's a picture or whatever, or voice or whatever, the computer's got to understand that stuff, and that's all of the work for you to do, whether it's face recognition or voice recognition or what. But that's those are the limits right now. And what we said was we did a lot of scanning. In about 2000, we had got a kind of production going. And I said, well, why did paper? I've got, I don't know, people would get, you give a talk and then you walk away with a videotape or you go to some place, you get a coffee mug or something like that. And I said, why just scan paper? We want to scan everything. We basically, anything that can be digitized must be digitized, and we want to get rid of clutter. So it was at that point we decided it was going to be everything, and those things were all, the goal was to encode everything into the hard drive. And also along about that time, it was, well, we said, gee, it's going to be, we'll be at a terabyte in maybe 6 or 7 years. And with a terabyte, you should be able to put your whole life at least at some resolution, or at least given that you have a terabyte, what would you do with it? I think that was kind of the way we went and started allocating space to that and in terms of email. And at that point in time, you'll note these are very low resolutions. Who would ever think of having just a 400 kilobyte JPEG image? But at that point in time, 400 kilobyte looked like a lot. I remember looking at the first 100 kilobyte things. Well, that's pretty good. You know, that's when you had had the first quarter megapixel cameras. So anyway, this was what a terabyte would look like. Now I'd say a reasonable number would be 10 terabytes at low resolution if you want to record video and audio. Now, if you want to have high fidelity, well, then you're talking tens of terabytes and petabytes, depending on the resolution, because it all video is whatever you want from that. It turns out with those budgets, why then? That a terabyte would give you 65 years, which I thought was about enough. Since then, I've gone past that, and it turns out that right now I'm at about a gigabyte a month, and on that list I didn't have I guess I did have every web page that I looked at. So a lot of that are really the web pages that are looked at, and then email now has lots of attachments, and then the photos are bigger and so on. But at least the number is about a a terabyte will hold at that resolution. But I don't think that's realistic for the life that we'd like to have there. So basically, it is that in these kinds of things, that we are our own data. So if you look in my collection, there's all kinds of artifacts, whether it's paintings or postcard or a card from my granddaughter or pins or medals or whatever, a pennant, and or just photographs and family kind of memorial. That's why that was the goal, to show you in at the very beginning the kinds of stuff, the range of things that in fact virtually nothing is off limits. So what you saw was pretty much the guts of what's in there, then you certainly have all of these things of various medals and awards and stuff like that. But some of the harder things are really notebooks. The nice thing is that, or the bad good news or bad news is people don't really have the engineering, don't tend to use the engineering, handwritten engineering notebooks like at least I use. So I have a large number of engineering notebooks that we all scan. And of course, those are totally unreadable by, the computer has no idea what those mean. So books and other artifacts. Here's a document that created some controversy within Microsoft a few years ago. On my website, I put the digital equipment VAX strategy note from 1979. And somebody said, you realize what he's put out there? He put this you'll note it was company confidential, confidential memo of some, wait, come on, folks. The company's been dead for, or been integrated into Compaq and then integrated into HP since 1992 It's totally irrelevant, and I put it there for the idea to show people, hey, here's a strategy. When people are always talking strategy. Well, I had a strategy, and it worked for about 10 years. People forgot to change it when I left, but basically, it got decked to be number two in the computer industry at that time. So you've got it now, so... Now, what do you do with it? And I think Jim's going to take over. I've got it all in there. And now the question is, now what?
Now what, indeed. So Gordon was off scanning everything, and he was building up this collection. And yeah, what do you do with it? Can you make any use of it? And eventually, he came grumbling into the office saying, it's all just a bunch of bits. He was really irate. I can't do anything with this. And I thought, wow, that's a real problem. And we were working for Jim Gray. And Jim, in the height of encouragement, offers to us that we've created the write once, read never memory. And thanks, Jim. That was really, really great. But he had a good point. Can we do, it was just a bunch of bits. Can we do anything with it? So we said, hey, this is a research project. Gordon's our guinea pig. We're going to run an experiment. And so he's got to do everything we can think up. And we're going to start building software. What should software look like if you wanted to digitize your whole life? So we started out saying, we're going to use a database. We're going to use SQL Server because we did our list of requirements and said, if we don't use it, we'll have to build it. And that doesn't sound like fun. And then we started building a suite of software around it. So sucking all our files into that database, writing a shell that lets you browse and search and look at things, letting you make comments in text or with audio, a tool for our browser where we record every web page that we visit, so that's not just the URL but an actual copy of the page so that if it disappears off the web, we've still got it, capturing our chat sessions, sucking in all our email. We set up a little rig in Gordon's office, so you'd phone his office, you'd hear recording. That's because California law says you need to be notified so that you can opt out. Hang up. We played for a while with TV and radio recording. That was fun. We created several terabytes of TV recordings and said, what would it be like to have tons and tons of TV recorded? The answer was overwhelming. And I think there's still a UI challenge there for how to deal with really massive collections of video In the end, we decided that actually having the radio and the television content recorded was not that interesting because we believe it'll all be available on demand eventually. What's interesting is the log of what did I watch, when did I watch it, what bored me and I shut it down in the middle, you know. It was very interesting that we were recording the radio and I used to always listen to the particular NPR news show, and then I had it on my pocket PC to listen to, you know, kind of TiVo'd. And I could fast forward, and I discovered that I only actually consume 15 minutes of the typical news hour. And ever since then, I've never been able to listen to NPR news again because I have this feeling like I'm wasting 45 minutes. What am I doing here? The screensaver, which may be the killer app here, because there's so much stuff you don't remember it's all there, so you won't even look for it. The screensaver brings it up to you. And we found also that if we want people to interact with the media, they have to be able to do it whenever they feel like it, however they feel like it. So whenever the material appears, you've got to be able to rate it. You've got to be able to comment on it, or you might want to follow up or make a note or something like that. So we built a screensaver that did that. We got GPSs and started recording our location and building map displays to render that. I'll tell you about the Sense Cam a little bit later. And then finally, we got software from Mary Trewinsky's team that helped us log everything we're doing with our PC. So what windows in the foreground, how long, how much mouse, how much keyboard activity, what am I doing with my PC? Here's Gordon's collection in 2008. So by the number of items, lots of web pages, lots of emails, lots of pictures, not so much of everything else. By space, video dominates and then pictures and audio. And through Gordon's lifetime, there's not a lot of video. He didn't have a lot of film. He said, gee, I really wish I had more film. Once we got to the stage of this, I realized how little there was from his lifetime. So I think a lot of modern people with their little video recorders and so on will generate far more. And the takeaway from this slide for all of us should be, in the future there will be video, and then audio and pictures, and anything else will just be a drop in the bucket. You will not care. In fact, like web pages, we realized with web pages we had this toggle to turn on and off the web page recording, and eventually I just leave it on, even when I'm debugging my own website, because I just can't click fast enough to care about how much storage is represented there. It just doesn't matter compared to this other kind of media. And by the way, it turned out to save my butt a couple of times when I hadn't backed up a certain version of code, but MyLifeBits had a version of it from the website I was debugging. So then around 2003, would it be, Gordon? Yeah. Lindsay Williams from the Cambridge lab came out with the Sense Cam. So I would have mine today, except for a journalist has borrowed it from me. It's a camera you wear around your neck, and it has sensors built into it. And the idea is that it takes pictures automatically at a quote-unquote good time. So first, it has sensors on it. So for instance, if the light level changes, so say I walk outdoors in the sunshine, it says, oh, scene change, take a picture. Let's grab where we are now. It has a passive infrared detector. That's the little gray bubble on the front there. That's like from a burglar alarm. It's a warm body detector. So, oh, a person's in front of me. Take their picture. It has accelerometers in it so that if it's jiggling, it says, oh, I'll take a blurry picture right now. I'll wait until it settles, and then I'll take a nice picture. So trying to get shots automatically. Here's Gordon with the standard issue Sense Cam plus digital audio recorder ready to go out and capture. And here's an example of if you take a bunch of Sense Cam pictures and put them together in time-lapse fashion, you get something like this. This is from a colleague in Cambridge riding the bike down to the train station and purchasing lunch, too. One of the things you enjoy collecting out of the Sense Cam is all these sequences of a heap of food on your plate dissolving down into nothing. So you can see the food going on there. And really what we started to get out of this, the point of having automatic capture in our web browser, having automatic capture with the Sense Cam, is that you get things you would never get otherwise. It's really interesting, like in the browser, it's too much work to even click one button that says save. It has to just be on. Same thing with the Sense Cam. You know, we all know families where child number one is born, and, oh, we take pictures of that cute kid and shoot videos and all this kind of stuff, and then eventually you go, I'm tired of being the photographer at the birthday party. I want to be part of the birthday party. And the media drops way off, and child number two says, why are there no pictures of me? Don't they love me? and the therapist ensues and all that stuff. But you get these pictures you wouldn't otherwise get when it's automatic with the SenseCam. And this is a collection of some of my pictures that are special to me that I got with SenseCam. There's a sequence here of Peter Hart, the head of Rico Labs, having lunch with me, and I would have never got out a camera and snapped all these, but he's very animated while he has lunch with you, and you kind of catch that mood of him here. And I have Ben Schneiderman, the famous UI researcher. When I went to visit him at the University of Maryland, he's on the far right in the middle. He's walking up and about to stick his hand out and shake my hand. I caught the moment that I met him. In fact, there's a postdoctoral researcher at Dublin City University who wore the SenseCam for an entire year as an experiment. He said, I'm going to wear it every waking moment for a whole year. And at the end, I presume I'm going to throw it as far as I can and get away from the thing. But we'll do the experiment, see how it goes. Actually, when the year ended, he refused to give it back. He's worn it for over 3 years now. I think, as far as I know, he's still got it on. Yeah, he took 800,000 pictures the first year. I think he's well up over 3 million now. He claims it makes his memory better. He loves it for a number of reasons. But I wanted to point out this idea again of capturing moments you wouldn't otherwise. He said, oh, I caught the moment I first ever met my girlfriend before I knew she would become my girlfriend. So that's a pretty neat moment. Capturing your location, recording meetings. Here's what you get when you're tracking what's going on your desktop. So Gordon's usage, hour by hour. George Robertson did this visualization from in this building. So hour by hour, how much time you're using it, what windows are in the foreground, so what apps are going on, what documents. You get a sort of time study of how you're spending your time with your PC. So in the end, what do we have? MyLifeBits, not a product. I mean, a suite of random applications, if you will, but a sort of proof of concept. And we started a workshop at ACM Multimedia looking into life logging issues, the CARPE workshop. We also funded 14 universities and gave them SenseCams and gave them the MyLifeBits software. And they went off and did all kinds of interesting things. We interacted with a lot of people throughout MSR. And between what we played with, what things we developed, and what we saw our colleagues develop, we got enough of a taste of it, a little foretaste to say, wow, I think we really see where we're headed, and we liked it. This is a bit of a surprise, because remember, we started out as just an experiment. People would say, why are you doing this? Well, because we can. You know, because Gordon had this idea of digitizing everything, and then we said, well, if we're going to have a terabyte hard drive, you could really go for it. Let's just try it. We didn't know we'd like it or it'd be useful, so at this point we go, wow, it's actually good. So the heart of our book is 5 chapters that talk about advantages that we found to total recall, to digitizing your life in memory, health, work, learning, and what we leave to posterity and how we enjoy things and tell stories. I'm going to only have time to touch on a few of them today, and even briefly in that, but at least I hope I'll give you a flavor of some of this. So first of all, memory. Human memory is pretty interesting, very different. Our bio memories are very different from electronic memory. Human memory is transient, so we lose things over time. We often assign memory to the wrong source, which, by the way, is deadly with our e-memories, because we're sure that we're looking for something that someone, you know, from a certain source, and it's not actually from that source. You can waste a lot of time with that. Bias, this is why they don't like eyewitnesses in a legal case to read the newspapers, because sometimes they've got all kinds of interesting occasions where they end up claiming for sure they witnessed something that never happened because they read it account otherwise. Absent-mindedness, so here you actually, it's not that you forget it, you don't lose the retention of the memory, but it just won't come to you when you need it. Likewise, that tip of the tongue experience, it's there, but it's just blocked, you just can't bring it up. And of course, memory is strange in any number of other ways. We're constantly sort of rebuilding memories and changing them. In contrast, an electronic memory is just kind of cold and calculating. It doesn't get bored, and it keeps all the trivia. And just a few samples here to give you a flavor of it. Greg Smith here at MSR did this visualization. So we're saying, here's kind of a breakdown of the ways we can look at some of Gordon's life bits. So let's say we want to look at what do we have from Florida from last year. So once we pick last year, it refactors to show you here's what's available from last year. So we go into location, and then now it'll show you what do we have by location. And we can drill down into what's from Florida. And then you might say, well, that's Florida of last year. What do I have from Florida in general? Never mind just last year, so you can get rid of the restriction of last year. And it'll refactor to show you that. Now, I did it on a little screen so I could do that screen capture. Here it is on a 18-panel LCD display. And in this high resolution, seeing your life laid out, visualization is just fascinating to make sense of things. You know, you think of the scientists with the big data sets, they always want to visualize, right? Well, we're all going to be like scientists with big data sets. We all need to make sense of it. We all need to visualize things. And this is part of Gordon's life. We showed this at Tech Fest a few years ago. And when it came up, Gordon just, just stood in front of it for a long time, because it's fascinating. There's so much of this when it's your life and you see your stuff and you start seeing those insights, it's really striking. Electronic memory, simple things in here, just how you sort things can make things easier to find. I had been having an email discussion about storage with some people, and I wanted to get back to an email because I remembered that guy said that really cool thing. That's my memory, so how do I find it? Well, I did a search for storage, and I found out storage in email, I had over 5,000 items. But if I just look at who they're from and I sort them by frequency, most of them are just from Gordon, myself, and Jim Gray, and it drops off rather quickly, and I'm able to just scan down the list, spot his name, and get to it. So even when I don't have a precise starting point, I can probably get to some good things. Another example is, let's say Gordon has a phone call with his real estate agent. He wants to sell his house. He was selling his house in Los Gatos, and she says, oh, yeah, let's look at this. I have a comp for you. So bring up your browser and I'll tell you how to look up this comparable property and we'll have a look at it, talk about it. So they talk about it in their phone conversation and they hang up and time goes on, a week passes, 2 weeks, and now Gordon says, oh, I want to look at that comparable property again. What's he going to search for? House? Real estate? Won't get him anywhere with all the stuff he's been looking at. But he says, okay, look, I know I had this conversation with my real estate agent. So if I go in and say, let's look at the call and what happened at the same time as that call, then not that much really did happen at the same time. You can scroll down, you can find the page with the house on it, even though it's not even on the web anymore. The point is, you start with a little memory hook. What do you remember? And then you kind of browse your way around to it. We found this is the nature of a lot of our searches, that you start with something you do remember, and maybe you remember it vaguely, maybe a little bit you're not sure, and you kind of want to hunt and browse and go on, you know, correlations and things that are linked in our system and help you get to what you want. Another area of advantage, and the one that excites me the most about total recall, is health. Gordon was in for a bypass surgery at Stanford Hospital, and I went in to visit him. And the doctor came in the middle and checked him out and looked at his chest. He peeled back the rug, looks at it, he goes, oh, yeah, looks like it's getting better. Great. Okay, Gordon, everything's excellent. Way to go. I'll see you later. He walks out of the room. I said, what was that all about? Gordon says, oh, well, I've got this blotch on my chest here. They're worried it might indicate an infection. If I'm infected, I got to stay in the hospital. If I'm not, I can leave, and it's my birthday this weekend. I really want to be home and have a birthday party. I said, well, great, you're getting better and you're going to get to go home, hey? He said, yeah, it's great, I'm going home, but I'm not getting any better. I said, what do you mean you're not getting better? The doctor just said you're getting better. He says, well, he said I'm getting better, but I know I'm not getting better. So what do you mean you know you're not getting better? He says, I know, because I've been taking pictures of it every day with my digital camera. And it's actually exactly the same. Our present medical system needs to change. Already the paper system is letting us down. Even though virtually always people have the chart available, also virtually always there's problems with missing information. RAND says we could save $77 billion a year if we had electronic systems. And we could save maybe 100,000 lives, because there's so many mistakes made by having the wrong information. So clearly, we need to get rid of the paper-based system and be electronic in all our hospitals and doctor's offices and so on. But even then, some of your information is at your GP, some's at the dentist, some's at the lab, some's at the hospital, some's at the chiropractor. It's spread all over the place. And the natural hub for it is you. We believe in health records by the individual, for the individual. You're the natural hub. You should own all your information. You should have all your information. And that's one reason why I'm so excited about the Microsoft Health Vault project. I just think that's outstanding. So Gordon actually went to and did this. He went, and right now you have to request in writing. It's a big hassle, but he requested. He got all his records, and he scanned them and sucked them all in, and he's taken some data points and even plotted them in Excel and tracked things. One of the universities that we funded, University of Pittsburgh, said, hey, this is interesting in its own right. What would it be like if you guys are doing My Life Bits? We want to do My Health Bits and work on a system for storing health bits personally. But let's go beyond that. The patient health records are electronic. You've got a copy. Good. But we can do more. Already, you can go to Philips and get a blood pressure cuff, a scale, a blood oximeter, what have you, a number of devices in your home that will wirelessly talk to a hub in the home that I think in their system dials up and sends stuff to your doctor. But you can imagine you could send it to your health vault or do any number of things with that information. You could have wearable systems. We have body bugs that are tracking our heat flux and tell us our calories and the number of steps that we take. There's lots of smart materials coming out. Eventually, you'll just put on your clothing, and that'll be tracking things. I saw a neat demo of some fabric at Dublin City University that would track the pH of your sweat and let you know when you're getting too dehydrated. And then when I talked to medical people about this and were telling the ideas in the book, they said, oh, yeah, but look, if you want to get the good stuff, you've got to go in the body. And so the final frontier, the exciting part of these sensors, is eventually there'll be things in seeing what's going on with our blood or tracking, you know, what's going on with all kinds of vital signs. And the leading edge of this is implants that people are already getting. So Gordon's pacemaker, for example, can wirelessly talk. Is it induction or something? But anyhow, it can communicate with the outside world and tell the scoop on what's going on inside. The payoff for health e-memories is enormous. First of all, like this thing about those blotches. Yeah, I'm thinking how many times you go to the doctor. When did you start having this fever, do you think? Oh, I don't know. I think I maybe got a little hot on Thursday. Maybe. No, it's going to all change. You're going to walk in. Huh, here's the graph of my temperature. You know, here's my blood pressure reading that I've been taking every night. Here's my weight. You know, real quantitative health, solid values. It turns out also that there's a huge problem with people taking their medication. Apparently, we're all really terrible at it unless it's pain medication, in which case we've got a built-in incentive to take it. But otherwise, people don't take it very well. But studies have shown that if you can see the impact, if you can see your blood pressure going down over time, you're more likely to take your blood pressure medication. We can discover correlations in your life, what, you know, leads to illnesses or different values going the wrong way. Eventually having electronic nurses that will proactively come in and say, hey, this is kind of trending the wrong way. Let me give you some tips. And that you could even interact with. There's been some interesting prototypes in this space. Now, of course, an electronic nurse will never be the same as a real nurse. But on the other hand, well, there's some disadvantages. There's some advantages, too, because people don't feel the same reticence about opening up about entirely everything that's going on to an avatar, it turns out. Compared to a real nurse, you might hold back a little bit. And finally, anonymous data sharing. If we can anonymize a bit of this information being collected and do expert systems on it, we can look for all kinds of stuff. I gave this talk at Xerox Park, and I had a guy come up to me at the end. He said, oh, I was one of Ed Feigenbaum's early students, and we had these really early lame expert systems, and we applied it to not very much data, and we found all these drug interaction problems. And he was super excited. He said, this blows my mind. If we had this much data and modern expert systems, it's unbelievable what we'll be able to turn up. Moving on from health, how about your everyday life and afterlife? I was working on my notebook in a restaurant one day, and I couldn't help but overhear these two old ladies talking to each other. And one says, oh, don't call and leave a message on my home phone because you can't. Call my cell phone instead because my home phone, all the messages are full. The whole thing is full because it's all my grandson, and I don't want to delete it. You know, isn't that the nature of it? It's not that she wants the transcript of his words. She wants to hear his darling voice, you know? We want that special connection, and we like recording that increased fidelity to have that richer storytelling. And some people have said, oh, you cold, heartless guys, you talk about shredding all your stuff and digitizing. That's so cold and techie. And I say, well, hey, you may say that, but while your physical mementos are up in the attic collecting dust, mine are on my screensaver, and I'm enjoying them. So who's cold and heartless? I'm you know, having a good time with them all the time, and yours are where you're never going to see them probably again. And it's amazing the level at which you connect to them. This is a timeline visualization of pictures of Gordon's son. And on the bottom is the distribution in time of the shots. And I look at it and go, okay, that's a distribution. But Gordon looked at it and he said to me, oh yeah, well, it drops off here because he went to college, and then there's a spike there, that was the family reunion, and then it picks up again at the end because that's when the grandkids are born, and so then we take lots more pictures with them. I went, wow, I mean, here even a histogram is telling a story to him. You know, even the data has a story in it. Take our locations. Here's a, some of my kids play hockey, and I went down to Southern California for a hockey tournament, and I have my GPS with me, and this here, the pink lines show where I went, and the red dots show where I took pictures. And so there's there we are down at the beach, and here we are back up at the hotel. And since you be in a place a number of times and the lines make a big mess on top of each other, we can pick a particular trip and then animate it. You can see the blue line showing as I drove up the highway. Hey, I got home after the weekend, I loaded this up, I saw this, I went, wow, I've got this. I would have just said trip to LA and had a few photos, if I bothered to even say that. Now I got the distinction between these little dots up here, I got the distinction between the hotel, the Starbucks around the corner, and the rink, which I would never have done on my own. Also, I have my calendar, which is full of when all the games were. I thought if I could just roll this up and send it to my mom, she'd finally think I'm a good son who actually tells her what's going on with the grandchildren. And I wouldn't have to do any work. So that was interesting enough that we actually hired an intern, and he worked on this for a summer of doing automatic blogging. So you take all your stuff in your calendar and you just maybe say, ah, these few shots are lame, or I leave out these, and then out it rolls and away you go and you get a blog from it. So we talked about automatically capturing things, web pages, pictures. If you're going to automatically capture, you got to think also about automatic summarization. So think of a sense cam. Now you're getting 3,000 to 4,000 photos a day. Whoa. And by the way, you can't look for the clusters of photos. It's just all photos. Well, Dublin City University, they took it and they started working on event segmentation based on they looked at faces. They looked at clothing patches. They said, what do we see that's different? They took the accelerometer from the sense cam and looked for patterns of activity. They were using GPSs also, so they had location. And they said, okay, if I want to summarize my day, what am I looking for? And their idea was, let's look for novelty. So if I'm having breakfast and it detects that I'm at home looking across at the same old face, that's pretty boring. It's pretty usual. But if I'm out for breakfast somewhere, that's novel. Probably more interesting moment of your day. And so they'd stitch together this visual diary of the day, and the boring breakfast ends up being a little thing in the corner, and things they think are novel, they just make bigger. And if you mouse over, you get that time-lapse view of whatever the event is, and they're segmenting by event. So nice automatic summarization. Now the ultimate summary will have to come when you pass away, and somebody gets your life bits, and they go, whoa, what is all this stuff, right? But there's some interesting angles to maybe even what you might consider digital immortality for total recall. I had lunch with Ed Feigenbaum down at Stanford, who's called the father of expert systems, and he drew this on a napkin for me. He said, yeah, Jim, when we started, we thought it would look like this. Oh, we'd have a bunch of logic, and we'd have a bunch of data, and we'd do this reasoning, and good stuff would come out. He said, but the insight that we eventually gained is it looks more like this. What we want is lots and lots and lots of data, and we really want to keep it simple. And I say, wow. What have we got with total recall? Lots and lots and lots of data. So even with Einstein and what he left behind, Carnegie Mellon lets you go to a virtual Einstein and ask questions. You get answers based on his writing and biographies and whatnot. A company called MyCyberTwin.com took the transcripts from the Simpsons scripts, and you can talk to Bart. What do you think of your dad, Bart? Well, my dad, Homer, he got a chess set once, then packed it away. When I asked him why, he said he's saving it for a brainy day. Do you have a pet? Well, who needs a pet when I have Homer? Actually, I do have Santa's little helper, too. He's a dog. Well, the scripts are nothing. When you think of a lifetime recorded with all everything you say, the phrases you tend to use, the facts about your life, it seems likely that we could do a pretty good job of simulating you. when you're gone. And think of what would it be like if you could ask your great-grandfather, you know, questions. Well, what was it like when you met great-grandma? Things like that. So total recall is coming. We think it's inevitable, and it's going to shake up society. That, like we talk about the Industrial Revolution and other shake-ups to our society, it's going to change it just as much. And like these other revolutions, these changes, some of them are just change. Some of them we view as bugs that need to be fixed, and some are just change. So, for example, we have automobiles. There's a bug that there's pollution coming out of them. But on the other hand, the fact that I can commute a number of miles every day to work, that's just a change to our society. Or that, you know, transportation is different so I can get fresh vegetables in the wintertime. But we do have to face up to a lot. A journalist recently said to me, he says, well, what are the problems that might stop this? I said, no, it's inevitable, it's coming. There are problems, but it's coming anyhow. Now, it'd be kind of like back when cars first came out, and they'd say, well, those automobiles, they're smelly, and they're noisy, and they scare the horses, right? There were problems, but it wasn't going to stop them. In the same way, we have problems we've got to face. Here's a bug for you. When ACM 97 came out, we put it on the web because we were interested in telepresence at the time, telepresentations. And within a few years, someone emailed me to say, hey, there's an audio file you've got. I can't play it anymore. And I checked out with our media team up here, and I said, hey, let's get that codec posted so that they can play it. And they said, they looked into it and came back and said, Jim, actually, we had a license from this company. The license expired. The company's bankrupt. It's in receivership. There is no hope that you will ever, I mean, it's illegal for us to let you play that clip now. And so we have to watch out. So here's Gordon's little flight of fancy of a poor, lost, and forlorn data saying, dear application, why have you abandoned me? I mean, we all know this too, that you have these formats that go stale. So there's a challenge here. I think there's a real opportunity. I mean, the ultimate in this is that we have virtual systems that can run every past software and hardware environment. You know, in between that, there's services that can roll things forward to formats that are still usable. And I think eventually, anybody who offers a backup service ought to also have a sort of freshener service that goes along with it that keeps things fresh. In the meantime, we try to go for what we call them golden formats, formats we think will survive. And my rule of thumb is if more than 10 million people are using it, then there should always be a market for keeping it usable somehow. Privacy, boy, this is a big one. But already, if you don't behave yourself on your next date, gentlemen, you could end up on don'tdatemgirl.com. And we all know stories of the YouTube videos that are out there and the surveillance cameras that are all over the place. So when we talk about audio-video recording, particularly in relationship to total recall, there are some serious privacy issues here. But I would argue that we've maybe crossed the line already for all the problems you think you're going to have, you already have. And I look to an experiment by Steve Mann that I think demonstrates this. So Steve gets a group of people, and they will wear maybe t-shirts like this that say, for your protection, video may be recorded and transmitted. You can't see well here, but this is sort of that smoky glass here, so there might be a camera behind it you don't know, or else they wear, you know, the bulb that looks like a surveillance camera on it. And you might, so they call it the maybe cam, you might be recorded. And Steve likes to do this because he wears this recording apparatus all the time, and he's being really hassled by people, and he gets mad when he says, you're hassling me, but you've got all these surveillance cameras up, so, you know, fair is fair. Anyhow, so his big thing is to go into some place with a lot of cameras with wearing these things and watch everyone freak out. The interesting point that I want to make here, though, is even if no one actually has a camera, you will get the same reaction. Okay? You don't have to be recorded for it to change things. Just maybe be recorded to change things. And I would submit to you that we are already there. I mean, besides the amount of surveillance that's out there that may be recording you already, if people want to do it personally, you can already go online and get a little USB stick that has a pinhole camera in it that will record a number of hours of video. Microphones are so easy to conceal stuff. You know, cell phone could be rolling, you don't know. In fact, actually, it's interesting with the Sense Cam. I went into a deli one time that was around my neck. And I walked up, and I'm buying the stuff, and the girl behind the counter goes, is that a camera? And I thought, oh, maybe it's going to be one of these moments when it's like, hey, shut that camera off, you know? And I said, yeah. And she said, oh, and kept going, because she presumed that I would have to hold it up and go click, click, click to take her picture. But actually, I took 3 or 4 pictures of her while I was in there. You never know. Then legally, will my electronic memories testify against me? What's going to happen here? Could I, you know, could this be a downside where I get called into court and have to bring these things back up? So one idea that's floated is, maybe we get some wrong on purpose. So if we inject some fake pictures and put some wrong locations in and stuff like that, then maybe the court won't be able to admit it. Sounded good, but a lot of legal people said, no, that's not going to fly. Maybe we could work on that. We could change our laws. I'm all in favor of this. I think that this should be treated more as like an extension of our biological memories than you know, some kind of piece of paper that can be subpoenaed. And it's interesting, there was a case where someone was trying to be compelled, the authorities wanted to compel him to hand over an encryption key to decrypt his drive, and the judge said, no, you can't do that. That's, you know, like testifying against yourself. Now, it's being appealed now. We'll see where it goes. But already, our laws are starting to grapple with this and say, what does this mean? Another example is where, you know, some have offered the opinion, hey, look, at if you're going to go after this stuff, all right, but we already make a distinction between saying, hey, you know, let me see your papers, and I'm going to strip search you. There's a higher level, higher standard needed for a strip search, and they said, well, at least ought to be like that. There ought to be an increasingly high standard. So there's some movement in the law, some discussion. In the book, we suggest, hey, how about we put it in a Swiss data bank? Now, whenever I say that now, the people go, yeah, but the Swiss are having to hand things over now like they didn't used to. But okay, I'm talking about how Swiss banks used to be, all right? And the idea is, it's the anonymous, it's the deniable place to store things. And if you think about technologically, there's a number of approaches we could have here. Imagine a peer-to-peer system where you don't know what you're storing even. You don't know who it's coming from. It's all encrypted. You never see what it even is, right? Things like that. There ought to be ways for us to, or at least to just take the sensitive parts that we have and lock them down and keep them safe. And by the way, maybe even have, you know, in the spy movies, and the spy has the code word, if he's called up and when he says a certain word, then they know on the other, oh, he's compromised, and they all bug out, right? They should have that too, where if I go to my Swiss data bank and I give the special password, it goes, oh, the stuff over here in this folder, shred, right? So here's another timeline like the one I showed you before. This is my web pages, and in the middle here, this big blank spot in the data distribution is where my hard drive crashed after 4 months of not backing it up. And until that day, I thought, well, it's kind of fun recording my web pages. Like, it's, you know, sort of cool. But the day that happened, I was surprised that I got really emotional. I was upset. And I was like, oh, no, like, my memories have been lost. And after that, I would start hunting for things, and I couldn't find them. I go, oh, that was in the 4 months that I lost. And I realized I crossed the line from, this is kind of fun, it's a novelty, to, I count on it. I expect this is what life is like. You know, it's like I wouldn't buy a house without flush toilets. Why would I want to have a browser that doesn't record every web page? That's how my attitude has shifted on it. And that's kind of how our attitudes have shifted on what we thought was just a crazy experiment with electronic memories. We think that today we talk about prehistory. Like, before there was writing, it doesn't even count. Eventually, you're going to talk about pre-total recall. Oh, those poor humans with their pathetically documented lives that lived back before in the 20th century. As the electronic memory revolution changes everything. Thank you. And now, questions. Go ahead.
This, I think, is about filtering. But is there schemes for prioritizing things to get through the deluge? Because what I'm seeing is the impact of just too much data makes people jaded and actually lose focus on all data.
Right, absolutely. So if you have too much data, you suffer from clutter. Oh, by the way, I forgot. You remember that picture of Gordon and the big pile of books? So part of that was to talk about clutter. One thing is, first of all, we feel incredibly decluttered by going digital. We're able to get rid of so much papers, and our offices are tidier, and there's an incredible feeling of liberation. It's that the computer's remembering for me, and I don't have to worry. But you have the good point about clutter. Now, and Gordon came in partway through the project, and he said, I got too many web pages, and a lot of them are practically the same thing, and I'm getting cluttered. He says, I need a delete button. We said, no, hang on, not necessarily delete button. Instead, we had an intern come in and do a near duplicate similarity detection, and then we just took the near duplicates and can shuffle them away. Voila, now you're down to what you want. And there's a number of automatic thresholds we can do. Now, for one thing, we can also mark, we have a little thumbs up button at the top, and we could say this is, you know, explicitly interesting. But besides that, another useful threshold we had was, remember we were tracking the window that was in the foreground and the time and the activity? So we could look at the web pages that you engaged with, and a really good heuristic I found when I was looking for pages would be say, eliminate anything that I spent less than 10 seconds on. And that gets rid of a whole bunch of pages, too. And then remember the Dublin City University example of looking for novelty and things like that. So again, these are some examples. There's a lot more. It's a great challenge to Microsoft. We have to deal with quantity and get rid of clutter. But one final thing, Gordon has the suggestion of the cloaking function, right?
Right.
Why don't you tell him about that?
I had proposed it. I can't get it anywhere. I've also proposed it to Apple so that we can copy it then.
See, if you don't listen to him pretty quick, you never know where he might go.
But anyway, the basic function is, because you do get a lot of things as you're moving along, and in the event that you find something, that you're looking for something by location, generally you look for things two principal ways. Where it might be, and then what the content is. So you're usually try to get something by content, basic or quote searching. But in the event that you have to go into a folder or something, and there's a lot of stuff there that's old, and you know that you're not going to use it in sort of that year, day to day. I want to cloak those. I want to cloak folders. For example, I've got folders for all of the financial. I got a folder per year, every year in my main.
Oops.
That's in my main. Kind of let's call it my business folder, and I like to cloak all those because I'm not. I know I'm not going to. It's unlikely I'm going to use them, but in fact, I want them there. I don't want to get rid of anything. Oh, that's the other thing. You had a talk here about delete. How many of you were at the delete talk? Anyway, we don't believe any of that, by the way. I listened to the talk, too. Jim, I couldn't get Jim to listen to it.
I won't take it seriously enough. I guess my initial response to it even would be anything you would have deleted, you could cloak. You could hide it away and say, don't return it to me unless I specifically. And you could have a second level of really lock it down. I mean, even put it on external drive and unplug it and stick it in the closet, right? But you never know the value that you're going to find. And I would like, for my cloaking, I have a folder just with bills. And as they age, I would like them to automatically become cloaked unless I say otherwise. Or if you look at sort of a least recently used principle, because I don't want to have to keep creating new folders by dates and so on. I just want to keep dumping my bills.
Well, you had a good example of looking for an old bill because you were trying to find a vendor that had a guarantee on it.
Yeah.
So you don't care about that bill this year because it's all, you really care year by year because the Internal Revenue Service wants you to deal with things year at a year, time basis. But then you're looking for a vendor that's 3 years ago or
then
5 years
then
ago.
Then you go back into the cloaked stuff or archived or something like that. Maybe we should move on. Another question out here somewhere? Yeah.
So you talked a little bit about the challenges with high-volume media, broadcast media, and those sorts of things, which if you glance away at them or you look at them, the parts that you experienced you wanted to capture, is there a way of having, say, an agent record for you on your behalf without you having to record it? Because many people are going to be looking at the same TV show. And I wonder if you started thinking about, rather than you capturing or acquiring all of those things and archiving them yourself, where you are archiving
like TV shows and stuff?
Yes, you're acquiring your attention.
Yeah, well, actually, for those, in the end, I don't really have any interest in capturing them because more and more, I mean, I'm virtually certain that 10 years from now, I'll just go online and whatever TV show I want to see or movie I want to watch again, it's just going to be there. So really, it's more about logging what I do, which is really interesting, by the way. I mean, I'd like the system to learn, even with my personal media. Oh, when that photo comes up on my screensaver, I always skip it, you know? Or when it comes up at a certain time of day or something like that, I'd like it to learn from my patterns.
But you have to have the equivalent of thumbnails there. In fact, we just had lunch with our co-conspirator on this, Roger Luter, and he said, gee, I'm recording lots of video now. I have 8 terabytes of video, and I calculated that high-res. So he had maybe 800 movies that he may want. He said, I'd record these movies or these shows if I think I might want them. But you need the equivalent of thumbnails or something that lets you go.
Yeah, he's overwhelmed by the size of his collection.
Yeah.
And he needs a recommender system.
He can't do anything with it. Yeah.
He said, I wish I had even random clips pop up to me to help suggest things. Yeah, let's take a question here.
I find it interesting you bring up the latest. I'm reading it right now. Uh-huh. But I have more questions about the social aspect of Total Recall, especially since I've kind of been living this lifestyle, also taking a lot of photos. I don't
sure.
just be taking some photos, but I have. And I have noticed, at least with most people, and sometimes even myself, when you are aware of being recorded, they do change a little bit, mm-hmm. what you might say. And even at Microsoft, sometimes they say, don't send an email, just call on their phone, come in person, when you don't want that physical trail to be there. Have you noticed people, when you are hearing your live bits, or the sensor cam, whatever it was called, do they tend to self-center, do they censor, do they tend to change their behavior somewhat, or at least...
In principle, you're absolutely right. So I think people are more sensitive to audio, though. So the pictures is not a big a deal. But when you record audio, they really start self-censoring. And I think the best example, actually, is politicians. So politicians are the leading edge of people who are recorded all the time. And what have they found? I better not say anything off the cuff. All you're ever going to hear from me is scripted, banal, just totally boring, safe stuff, right? And that is the risk. And I'm glad you brought that up, because in the context of Total Recall, we're saying some aspect of it is inevitable and is coming. The continuous AV is least interesting to us. I like it for holidays or birthday parties or things like that. But what I'm really excited about is having a record of everything I read, of giving students the ability to record all their educational experiences, of giving, you know, information workers the ability to record all the kind of information that they deal with and have that at their fingertips and use it, of enabling all the health data to make us healthier, you know, things down the line there. And the last thing and the least thing is the continuous AV. Now, that said, the technology is there, and you're right, it does make you behave different. And my point with the maybe cam is, even maybe being recorded will change your behavior. Another question back here?
Yeah, I wanted to kind of follow on that. So at least very anecdotally, so N of one, the scenario where I want the audio in particular, maybe the video, and maybe there's a sort of a DVR. Wait, somebody said I was supposed to get something when I'm here at the grocery store, and I don't remember what those things were. And I want to be able to roll time back to that, or mark this thing as important. And that level of explicitness, the save button phenomenon that you talked about, I think is, you're right, that there's a nightmare associated with that.
Mm-hmm.
But making all of it archived and, you know, saying, oh, we don't think the audio and the video are that important, it feels like that's kind of on a collision course with itself. And again, Hannah's willing,
yeah.
So I don't know.
Well, so I have a couple of things to say about that. One is, there's an interesting, what was that little thing you wore in the belt with the... Deja vu. Deja vu. There was this deja vu camera, and it was recording video on a continuous loop, like a 90-second buffer, and if you push the button, it said, the past 90 seconds is interesting, keep it. So that's another interesting model where you're not necessarily intimidating people that you're recording everything, and you could maybe have a little, you know, flash go off to say, oh, I just kept the past, and they know. The other part of it, though, is you want to be reminded, and I think there's some great products that we love, a product called Recall, R-E-Q-A-L-L. And when I want to do reminders, if I think of a good idea while I'm driving, I call Recall on my phone and I say add, and I say what I want to remember. And you can say, buy milk on Tuesday. And on Tuesday, you get a reminder. You can say, I need to buy milk when I'm at the grocery store. And it has location.
And he's now trying to make that work with GPS. So you're in the grocery store.
So when you're at a location, says, you'll get that reminder.
You got to get...
They have the here and now reminders. What applies to here and now? Yeah.
Yeah, so this is a follow-up adoption. I see pieces of this vision happening already. So
yeah.
It should be in
yeah.
It should be.
It's happening all the that's one of the points of all of this too, that in fact you are doing it. We realize we're doing it. I don't know. I personally believe it is the trajectory for the personal computer. What is the personal computer all about? It's this. It's your surrogate memory. And you know, that's what we're all engaged in.
We were afraid the book would come out too late. And since we released it in September, iPod Nano said they're recording video in steps. Samsung's come out with a new GPS enhanced camera. I mean, this is moving rapidly.
So you're showing, you know, this is what would happen if you bought in sort of full lifestyle. And my question is, do you think people are going to go there, or are we going to see some of our small startups do little pieces?
No. Little pieces, absolutely, which is already happening.
But it's step by step.
And you get, so we mentioned Recall. There's another product, Evernote, where you can snap pictures with your phone, and it'll do OCR on it. You get, so health alone, so talk about little pieces. Some people will say, I just want improved health, and they'll use the health fault, and they'll record more stuff, they'll wear the devices. Someone else will say, I want that digital photo record. I'm going to go crazy with my photos, and I want to have the management for it. Different people enter at different points. Ultimately, though, it's all going to spread and build, and one thing that we learned is there's a lot of power of bringing things together. For us to be able to say things like, when was it on that hot day? What happened the same day as I emailed? I mean, right now we have too much in different silos, and it's a real challenge to Microsoft to help us integrate across the silos and use the correlations between them to give us real power.
What type of work can be done to look at like collaboration? So, for example, you were at a given point in time, somebody else, like, were you there like a week ago, and then trying to put together interesting parts, or multiple people having multiple views of the same type of event? Because right now you've talked about it as an individual, but it's interesting to say, I take a sliver of a piece and I want to share it with somebody else and then put that together.
I'd say we didn't consider that, and within, it's come up, some of the things, when you look at Facebook, there may be something there, there's a source of other content that's going there. I don't really know how you sort of fuse this stuff together, because one of the things is really keeping a lot of this private in terms of that's what you're doing.
But if I could interject there, though, but for public moments, so a couple of scenarios that I think would be great to take advantage of. So say you're at a family gathering, all you need is the one person of that bent, I won't say anal, but the person who does want to comment and mark it up and make it pretty and stuff, for us to all take advantage. Or for another example, imagine, so I mentioned I'm a hockey dad. Here's what I would love is, I go to the rink and I watch my kid play. There's cameras all over the rink and they're recording the game. I go home and of course I fast forward to where my kid made a good play. And I mark that. In fact, maybe I don't even mark it. Maybe this isn't just notes that I watched it 17 times. At the end of the season, the system just looks at it and says, well, here's all the bits that people watched a whole bunch of times. And right now, you see somebody generally goes and spends like 97 hours constructing the end of season video. We could just do that automatically. And plus, you could do more. So I might have said a comment. I might have said, wow, great goal. Or I said things about it. We could help. We could share. And so, yeah, there's a lot we could gain out of sharing. We didn't do work on that. And let me add, this book is not about the work that we did. Again, we only got a little sliver of this, but we got enough. We see where it's going. This book is about the future. It's about where we're heading. I think it's very important for all of us. It's a revolution coming that we all need to come to grips with. I'll take your question right here.
I have two questions. As it stands today, if you started life blogging, what kind of software is commercially available for organizing and parsing data that we can capture via video or images or text or whatever? And the second one is Microsoft pioneering any of this revolution? Are there teams at Microsoft that are planning to implement software like you talk about? For example, I've tried using Health Vault, but it doesn't come anywhere close to the MyLifeBits. It doesn't allow me to do anything that I want.
Right,
and you can't upload images.
It's very basic and rudimentary and almost laughable.
One of the things is there's a chapter with 10 startups in there of things that can come. And so the idea was really to stimulate within this environment. We just think that that's again, it's the inevitability.
Yeah.
And that's really what's happening. And as you guys become aware of this is what you're really, we think this is what you're really doing here. Or this is what we're all about. You know, unless you're working on databases for, you know, genomes or something that's in another particular application domain. But anything around personal computing, that this is it. This is where we're.
And by the way, is Microsoft innovating? When we started, there was no desktop search.
Mm-hmm.
And
in fact,
Gordon sent a memo saying, we need desktop search. And their answer was, why would anybody want that?
Yeah, and furthermore, I said, and by the way, here's a company that we ought to buy.
But we didn't.
Actually, Steve Sinofsky, I think Jim Gray had to intercede and said, well, really, Gordon's okay, you know. He's just very intense that when he wants something, he goes after it. And
you got another question here?
When you guys accumulated all the data, then obviously one of the core things is to relive your life, right? It's not just recall, but really what you're doing is reliving moments as well. Have people really looked into what it takes to relive moments in post-fidelity? Like, has anybody like really thought about that?
Well, there's the dimensions you can push of it, right? Where, you know, higher def video and, you know, there's some research demos of smell playback and things like that.
It was really prompted by what he mentioned earlier, which was, and what you actually mentioned, like, maybe I take my point of view in a restaurant, but it would be nice to have more context around what actually created that memory. And that's what really prompted this question.
Yeah. What's funny, though, is that the way things are going is in these areas that we don't think of a memory, right? So we would think our senses, and I'd like hi-fi, you know, video and audio and surround sound and smells and stuff like this, and instead we're getting temperature and humidity and what was the RPM of your car and how many loads did you do in your washer. So it's not quite playing out how we might expect, but there's also some real power in that to where you could, you know, to help you find things, to say, oh, I'm looking for the stuff that happened on the day when I did all that laundry. So, yeah.
What about doing something like organizing the stuff from your MyLifeBits by how many Bing hits it gets? How many Bing hits? Like, because he would say, you know, this piece of my life is very close to what the web already knows about. This piece is not. This piece is more uniquely me versus something that's close to what the internet already knows about.
So that would sort of be what's the stuff that I have that's secret? That would be the stuff that I've, what haven't I revealed?
Or just what do you have that isn't already known to the greater internet?
Interesting. Okay. Interesting suggestion. We'll take another one here.
Yeah, this is a pragmatic question that, you know, if you have everything collected in, let's say, one place, and you are, there's specific scenarios, you've been working in company X, Microsoft, and then now you move to join company Y, which is Google, and then what happens to all those?
That's one of the challenges.
That's in the book.
Because you've got the lobotomy problem. You know, and in fact, some of the people, and I don't know what you guys do, but Jim Gray and Jim Gemmel and I certainly have the one memory problem. We said, life is too complicated already. We can only have one memory. And so things are also always crossing over. Gee, that's a professional thing. And then, there's going to be a committee meeting on this topic. And we just can't separate those things. And so there may be some service that as you leave, LCA, the legal guys say, well, we will give you your lobotomy.
Hand over this part of your brain.
Hand over this part of your
brain. And we discussed this at some more length in the book. I mean, one point I'll just mention from what we say in the book also is the enforcement side of it will always be on what you reveal, because no one will ever actually be able to police what you keep. And so the question is, even if you're supposed to give it up, will that be observed any more than the posted speed limit on a deserted stretch of highway? Over here.
So the video was talking about, you know, 100 years of life and everything like that. And some people believe, like Ray Kurzweil, we're just about on to infinity of life, the singularity upon us. So how are you thinking about those sorts of potential things and extending biology so, you know, we live to be 300 years old, and then how do we capture that amount of data? what does that even all mean? And then how do we not become like the Borg? You know, having all this data.
The media problem is enough on all of this for, you know, we're worried about how do you keep data 100 years. I think that's more of our concern right this minute in terms of how are we going to make that data available over a couple of generations. Although, if we look at the paper version of that, after a generation or two, people, anything that you might have kept, it gets thrown of a couple of generations gets thrown out. So maybe these bits will get thrown out. But we, in principle, we want to make the bits as good as paper, which that's a challenge for you guys. That's a challenge for us all.
Yeah, and by the way, feel free to leave here. It looks like we're going on and on.
Yeah,
yeah, right. That's a great challenge to Microsoft. Imagine that people are coming saying, I would like to pay for a service to keep my bits for 100 years. How would we do it?
All right.
That's a great challenge. Move to book signing? Okay, and come around the book table and we'll talk to you while we do that too.